All right, so we will continue with our schedule for today. Next up in the speaking schedule is going to be Akshanta Sawant. And what she's going to speak about is securing APIs with policies. And this should be a really interesting topic because this is the first time I've seen anything on policy being presented on API security. So I'm really looking forward. I look forward to seeing your presentation, Akshanta. And I just want to remind everyone, submit your questions in the Q&A tab. And this will be the last presentation before our midday break. So this should be really exciting. You've got the floor, Akshanta. I look forward to your presentation.
Thank you. Thanks, Salisa. So we can get started? Okay. All right. So hello, everyone. Thanks for joining. So my name is Akshanta Sawant. I'm an Associate Solution Architect at Epicero. Also, I'm a MuleSoft Ambassador. And today, we'll be mainly discussing about securing our API with policies. Okay. So to begin with, like, this is the agenda for today's session. We'll be first discussing what is API security and what is the need to secure APIs, what are the major security threats, and then we'll deep dive into the API policies and how API policies can be helping us to achieve a full-fledged security from the API perspective. And then also we can take up some Q&A sessions. If you guys have any questions, feel free to ask me, okay? So moving ahead, this is something like the newspaper links and all. I mean, mainly about the API data leakage, the API the abuses like that we've been facing. So these are quite common, and I've taken these links from the recent newspaper article. I mean, the news articles basically, and we can see like how APIs have been actually like there have been malicious attempts, there have been data leaks and all the data breaches. And why is this happening? Is because large number of organizations, government, public, almost all the major sectors, right? They have been using APIs, and with the large number of, I mean, increasing the usage of APIs, basically. With that, it comes the API security. API security is also, I mean, the most important factor which you should be considering. So moving ahead, apart from that, like even that being said, as per the Gartner's prediction, also they have been said that like by 2022, the API abuses like will be the major, the most frequent attack, we can say. So this is the need of an hour. Like, we need to really think much about in detail about the API security, and not just developers or the architects, but everyone. I mean, from the stakeholders, everyone should be actually aware about the API security, and they must think a lot about securing their APIs and all. Okay. So why is API security like how is it different from the traditional approach? So traditionally, we all are aware, like we have been using the traditional browsers. I mean, wherein the application used to be in silos, and there used to be a web application which used to actually do a communication with the backend systems, we can say. So if you can see this diagram as well, so there used to be a user used to actually communicate with the browser, and then there used to be a data which used to be sent to a backend application. So in that case, the data, I mean, all the details was actually processed by the browser itself, okay? So the application was not much impacted, we can say. I mean, the security perspective, the browser was taking care of the security. But with a modern application wherein we are using the APIs, so at this level, what happens is your API is the one who's the communication link, we can say. So it is the one which is actually carrying the data to and forth. So we need to be very careful when we are sending the data, like what our request is, what response we are getting. We should limit ourselves to the number of what kind of access we are giving, basically, or who are the ones who are actually having access or rights, basically, or what we can say. Yeah. So apart from this, the request which has been carried, right? So we need to limit our information. So we should ensure that the large number of data is, we are not giving up maximum information to the user. We're just exposing what is required, and we're limiting the number of, limiting the information, basically. So this is how it is. Like our API is the main focus here, and this, which is like actually taking care of the security and everything. Okay. So apart from this, what are the main security concerns, we can say? So we have major security concerns, and these are mainly related to API. So I've listed them, a few of them. Like it could be a security misconfiguration. There have been some security thread which has been left neglected something. or it could be an injection or passing attack. So we are aware about the header inject, I mean the injection, the database level injection, but it could also be as APIs are the one which are exposed to the front ends, or I mean the users or the calling systems. So in that case, the injections are the one which could be carrying some malicious data or something. So we need to ensure that our APIs are protected from such kind of attacks as well. And then the improper assets management. So what could be the case is like, suppose if the non-production data or the staging environment, okay, is being exposed. So the hackers could also get some information or get some links, okay, to our actual API, which is actually in production. So we need to ensure that not only the production environment, but also our non-production environments, they are being like carefully streamlined. We are like actually taking care of all the assets. Okay. Apart from this, there could be an object level authorization. I mean, broken object level authorization. So something like the OAuth or whatever identity management or access management we're configuring. So there could be some leaks in that, and the hackers might take advantage of these links as well. Okay, or there could be like excessive data exposure. So as I said earlier as well, so we need to ensure that the data which we are exposing to the external user should be like something which is actually what we can say is something needed, and we are not overexposing our data. I mean, we should give our client the information only which is required, right? And not something like on an external, like more than what is required basically. Apart from this, yeah, the lack of resources and rate limiting. So rate limiting, I guess you must have heard about, like if the number of requests and all, if they're increasing, in that case, there could be a denial of service attack and all, like something like the hackers are trying to like actually send large number of requests and they're trying to get your servers down. So, okay, they could make several API calls and all. So you need to ensure, maybe you can do this something using an SLA tier-based the level of access, or you could be actually protecting your resources and all. Okay, so these are a few of the security concerns which I have listed down, but there could be definitely a few more. And we should be like taking, when talking about the API security, we should consider the holistic approach. I mean, from a total API security thing. Okay, so moving ahead, what are the different API attacks we can say? Like, yeah, these are the most commonly identified API attacks, the injection attack, the denial of service attack. So we all have heard about these attacks almost on a, like they're quite frequent, I could say, the authentication, the data exposure and all. So these are the attacks which are like very common, and these attacks are the ones which are result of the security threats which we have identified earlier. So going ahead, what are we going to see is, what are the security measures which we can implement? So by now we have seen like what are the security threats, why API security is very much important, what are the different kinds of attacks. But a major topic here is like securing APIs with policy. Okay, so in that case, we need to ensure that how our APIs will be most secured and how we can achieve it using policies. All right. So here comes the top five policies which I have listed down, and I have personally used them as well. Okay, so when we are saying the top five policies, I mean you need to identify like what policy or what security policy works best for your application. Some might have an on-premise application, some might have cloud application. I mean the cloud APIs basically. Like I mean the also from the API perspective, it could be like the REST APIs or could be the SOAP APIs. So we are aware, like from the SOAP perspective, the security is quite like on a better side, but it has its own disadvantages as well. And on the REST API, is quite flexible, but the security stuff we need to take care of. So as for the API, the API's environment and what is the client's requirement, what type of response request are we expecting? So accordingly, we need to design our security policies as well. Okay, so we'll be just discussing about each of this policy in quite a depth. Okay, and then we can just maybe see how we can implement them out. I have actually implemented a few of them, and we can maybe just discuss on detail, like if you all are having any questions as well. Right. Apart from this, this is the API gateway. I mean, you can consider this as an architecture, which we can keep it as a base while implementing our API policies. So the purpose of API gateway, it acts as like a screening thing. Like you can consider you're having a watchman for your building and the security premises basically, and is actually checking your identity card if it's valid or not. And only if it's valid, it'll allow you to enter the premises. Okay, so that's what the role of API gateway is. So it acts as a middle layer, okay, the passing layer basically. Normally a client application or an API will send a request, which will be first, before the request goes into a backend system, the backend APIs, it will be first received by API gateways, okay? And once it is received by API gateway, so API gateway, whatever policies we have implemented, so these policies could be like the security policies. There are actually different kinds of policies you can apply on your API gateway as per your requirement. But today we'll be mainly talking about the security policies only. There could be like transformation policy or something like logging policies as well. Okay, but mainly we are focusing here as the security policies. And yeah, I have listed down a few which we have seen. The spike control, authentication authorization, IP blacklisting, whitelisting. Then there is an XML or JSON threat protection and the tokenization, detokenization. Okay. So moving ahead, yeah, API gateway is the one which you can directly apply this policies on your APIs. Okay. Basically the API gateway, and you could be exposing a basic endpoint, or you could be using, if you're using a proxy application. So that provides another level of security. So in that case, you can also apply these policies on the proxy application. Even that works. Okay, so it's completely like up to you, like how you want to design your security architecture. In case if you're having different number of microservices, if you want to club them all together and apply the same policies over all of them, even that is fine. Or you can group your applications and create a mesh kind of thing. Like the outer layer security will be something more protective, and the inner applications which have been called by the outer application, they could be having some less security or something like that. So that is a grid or a mesh which you have to visualize, and you have to create the security policies accordingly. Okay, so moving ahead with the first policy, which is like a policy we can say like rate limiting or the spike control. This is the most common one. So when do we need rate limiting or spike control is, like suppose if there are a large number of requests, okay, during we have witnessed the sales and all, okay, during the application or during the peak hours, normally the applications, they receive a heavy load, or this might be an attempt from a hacker as well to maybe shut down your application to bring your server down. So in that case, you should be during the load testing of your application, right? So you should be able to identify what is the maximum threshold value or what is the maximum load your application can sustain. Accordingly, you can set the limit. Okay. So here we can say we can consider like the 400K is being set as the maximum limit. Okay, 40K, sorry. So if it reaches this limit, the whatever requests are received beyond that, so those will be like scrapped out. Okay, that is in case of rate limiting. But what happens in spike control? Spike control and rate limiting, they're quite of similar. But yeah, in rate limiting, whatever is the excess number of requests, they'll be completely cut off. Those requests will be lost. But in case of spike control, those will be retained in the form of queue. Okay, they'll be stored in the queue, and they could be processed later by some other, after a certain duration of time, there is some time gap or window slot, which we can say. After the particular window frame, these requests are being tried again. So I guess we have it over here. So if you can see in this diagram, a few requests which have been accepted, okay, that is during the particular quota. And other than that, if the number of requests, it increases that particular limit. So those requests have been stored in a queue. And after a particular duration of time, those requests have been tried again. So these are the main like spike control and the rate limiting. This is all about the spike control. And this mainly is helpful in case of denial of service attack, distributed denial of DDoS attacks and all these things. So yeah, and these are the most commonly used as well. Mainly experience APIs, what we call them, or the APIs which are like actually exposed to the front end. So that is the place where we can actually make use of rate limiting. And if we are actually expecting large number of requests, mainly in case of e-commerce site and all. So yeah, there we can actually implement this API, this request. Moving on to the next, like the authentication authorization. This is the most common and the most important one. almost every applications and all we have been using, we experience like we have to authenticate, we have to authorize. So just the basics, like what is the difference between the two? So I'll take the previous analogy again. Like I said, like API gateway is it acts as a building's watchman, and it will allow you to actually pass through it. So that is something you're doing authentication, but you need to authorize yourself as well, right? You need to make sure that you are eligible to make those changes. You are eligible to access that resources. Okay, so your API is actually having that authorization. So in order to implement this too, I mean, we actually need to be having the authentication and authorization implemented. So in order to implement these two, there are several tools and all, or tools, I mean, services which we can implement. So the most common ones are OAuth, JWT, okay, SAML-based authentication. We can also go ahead with the basic authentication. So when it comes to authentication authorization, there are several mechanisms we can actually implement. So you all must have heard about the bearer token and all. Okay, that is something which comes. So the most basic one when it comes to authentication is the basic authentication. It has a simple username and a password. Okay, there is nothing much or nothing more extraordinary you need to configure in terms of that. When we just go ahead a bit deeper down, if you just wanted to make it a bit complex or maybe a bit sophisticated, so in that case we can go ahead with the OAuth. Okay, so in case of OAuth, we'll be having an authentication server, which will be generating a token itself. And then using the token, it's called as a bearer token, okay? You can also have like authentication, the bearer token, which is generated by the OAuth server, or maybe you could be having different identity access management tools as well you can use. There is Okta, there are different tools basically, okay? So you can use them as well to make sure that you're authenticated. And once that you're authenticated, you will authorize it. So for the authorization as well, you can use the same if you have the authorization access to use it. The second policy, which I was talking, I mean, the first one, we can say it's basic authentication. The second one is OAuth. The third one we can talk about is JWT token. So JWT is like a JSON web token, which is also most commonly used the authentication authorization policy. The only difference between OAuth and JWT is like JWT will be having a lot of payload as well. I mean, some secure, we can also enclose some JSON web token or JSON data in it. Okay, so that is the major difference between OAuth and JWT, but both of them serve the same purpose. Apart from this, you can have basic authentication with LDAP, wherein you're storing your credentials in some directory. Okay, so that is one. There are also SAML-based authentication. So there are different authentication servers which you can use, the different vendors who are providing this service and all. And these are the main, I mean, the most important. So common example we can take is while you're using a Google API, or maybe while you're using some third-party application or an API. So you're directed to some trusted site, right? And that's wherein you're actually asked to send credentials and all. Like you have to enter, like without actually creating an account. If I can give you an example, like you want to create an account with like Facebook API, okay? But then while creating an account, you've been redirected to Google's API or something like that, which is like a trusted site, and you can use the Google's API to authorize your Facebook API to create an account and everything. So with the help of Google's API, you're actually logging into Facebook API. So that is in the background, what's taking place is the authentication and authorization. So you're actually allowing a third party service to authenticate and authorize yourself, and so that it will be like much more easier to get access. And from the security perspective also, it's better, right? Because you're not leaving your data, your credentials with some third party site, which could be like which could be using your data information. Okay. So apart from this, this is how the actual mechanism and everything takes place in case of authentication and authorization. Okay, so first we'll be sending out a registration, okay, the authentication server, and then we'll be getting back a client ID client secret. So that the client ID client secret will be received by the authentication server, okay, and this is the one API basically which is making a call. okay, to the authorization server. So for authorization server, you can take some example of maybe Okta, Salesforce, or any, I mean, there are different kinds of authentication server which are actually present, which could help you with the, which all the services and all. It could be either a JWT, I mean, the OAuth is the one, Auth0 is the one which is the most common authorization server, okay? So it helps you up with the client ID secret, and then the client credential is granted. I mean, you ask for the request, right? Request grant. And then the request is grant, access is granted to you. So once you have this request, okay, so your API will go to the backend server, or maybe you can say the, the application, okay? And then you'll be like verifying your bearer token, which you have received from the authentication server. And once your bearer token is validated with your resource server or the backend application, so that's when the, you'll get a service response back as well. Basically, whatever is the response which is expected. Okay, so this is all about the authentication and authorization. You can also, this is a very simple process. It might look a bit complex, but basically, yeah, it's very easy to implement with the help of API gateway, of course. Okay. Moving ahead, yeah, the third policy which we are implementing is IP blacklisting and whitelisting. So this is also a very easy one and a most common one which is commonly used. So if you want to block some of the IPs, right, which we find that they are malicious and they could be like they are not supposed to be actually sending a request to our application, something like that. In that case, we can implement IP blacklisting. Or if you want to allow only a particular IP range to our, the API should receive requests only from those IP ranges. So in that case, we can whitelist those IPs. So this is, as the term itself, it looks quite simple and easy, I feel. You can actually, if you can see over here as well, you're just clicking on this API and you'll be just adding it to whitelist, or you'll be like maybe adding it to blacklist. So if you're working in an organization which is like a private organization, and if you're expecting a request from only a few of the IPs, so you can just select give access to those IP ranges. Basically, you can only give access, whitelist those IP ranges. And so there is no chance of like the hackers and all trying to access your data, okay? So there will be like some confined region or confined IPs which will be like sending out the request to your application. So this also provides one good security measure, okay? It is also one of the commonly used in securing your APIs if they're actually having some critical information. So apart from this, the next one, the fourth one, would be like the XML or the JSON threat protection. We can also call this as the parsing attack or parsing protection against the basically the parser. So I'm not sure if this image is quite clear, but if you'll see, there are like several nested JSON. Okay, so similarly, there could be an XML as well, or any kind of language you're basically using. So it could either be JSON, XML, or anything. So normally we have seen in case of JSON or an XML, we have a nested loops, like, and whatever the nesting we have, the innermost nesting, so we call them as depth. So if in this case, if you'll see the number of, the depth is like 3, okay? So that's the reason why, the number of depth is increasing. So we can set a limit to it that I'm setting my limit to like something 3 or 4. So if the number of depth which I'm getting, the innermost value, so the root or the child elements basically in this case, if it is exceeding a particular value, I can say that the it is not allowed something, or container that is not valid. Like what I'm getting, maximum allowed is 1. That is that's what a response I'm getting over here, right? Because it has exceeded the depth. So why are we limiting this? Because if the length of the JSON or XML file, if it is increasing, in that case, there are chances that a hacker might add in some malicious content in it, and it might get neglected. So we need to make sure that the length of our JSON or XML, whatever we are passing, it should be some limit, some standard limit, which is like the maximum or maybe the average limit we can set it up. And if the XML or JSON's length is increasing, then in that case, we can actually say that the maximum value allowed is like, it's not permitted. So I'm not sure if you all have, this is not commonly used, but yeah, it should be used because our APIs are the ones which are carrying requests, right? So in this case, how can a hacker be like successful is he can actually send, if this policy, I mean, if XML JSON threat protection is not implemented. So in that case, what he can do, he can actually send a large payload, okay? And a large payload, which could be having like some malicious data or maybe some hidden, I mean, something like which is not actually accurate. And that could actually fetch him some amount of information from API. I mean, if our APIs are not fully secured in that case, he'll be at least getting some hint or some idea about the API, basically via the response or maybe some error message. He might get some information, right? Or if he's successful in attempting and breaking through the API, so in that case, he could actually inject some malicious other data as well. And this injection can be prevented using the XML and JSON threat protection. Yeah, that's all about the XML and JSON threat protection. Apart from this, the last one, which is like the tokenization and detokenization. So mainly, if you see this tokenization, detokenization, it is used when the PII information is involved. Okay, when there are quite a high like security information, like credit card information, bank details, or your personal social security number, all this crucial information is involved. So at that place, what I can actually do is tokenize and detokenize your data. So basically, this is the data which you will be receiving, the sensitive information, which you will be receiving at the API with the API request. So what you'll do, you'll tokenize it using some algorithm, okay? And these are actually readily available with most of the API gateways. They actually provide the services, the tokenization, detokenization. All you need to do is go ahead and just implement them. So mostly they will be applied to your credit card information or some crucial information and all. And after that, it will be like encoded. And once you have your application where you're processing, they'll be passed as it is. And if you want to store it in a database and all, they'll be stored as an encrypted one. If you want to detokenize it at some place, if you want to perform some operation on it, you can detokenize it as well. Okay. So with the help of this, if your payload is being printed somewhere, or if you have applied some loggers and all in your application, you're doing a logging operations and all. So at that level, you're actually ensuring that your this information is not been leaked out, or it's not been visible to all the other applications. I mean, to other users as well, and even the developers from the ones who are in the monitoring team or maybe in the production support team. So these information are the crucial information, right? Which is like a user's identity. So those should be protected. And tokenization and detokenization is actually the one which provides the best way in order to like protect the information. So apart from this, like, yeah, we have majorly covered all the policies and all. So I'll just review through all of them. I'll just go through all of them. Like, we have discussed the importance of API security. We should also remember the Gartner's code, which is said like in 2022, API security will be the most frequent attack. Okay, we have discussed about the API security threats. What are the different kinds of threats we have been facing, and what are the different attacks, and how security misconfigurations and all could lead to this attacks, which are very severe, and it could actually harm an organization, because this is a major thing. And we have seen in the first slide as well how it was printed on the newspapers. I mean, almost all the articles and all, they have been like the recent ones, and those are. So they have actually been published about the major security threats, how the data, there has been data leaks and everything. So these are the top policies, top security policies which you can implement. Apart from these security policies, like the spike control, authentication authorization, the IP blacklisting, whitelisting, XML protection, tokenization. Apart from these basic policies, also what you can do, you can just, at the application level as well, you can ensure your data is secured. You can use some cryptographic algorithms and all. In case if you're using a REST API, you can ensure that you're using the TLS security. You're using HTTPS instead of HTTP. So there are some small minor details which you need to be very vigilant about. And that's the only way we can actually tackle, and we can make a use of good API security thing. So yeah, these are a few security policies from the API security perspective. Apart from these policies, we can also have several other policies like transformation policies and all. There are compliance policies. Okay, transformation policy, can give you an example of message loggers and all, something like header injection, header removal. Like if you want to add or remove some of the headers and all, or if you want to apply some message logger at the API gateway level so that you can have a track of what headers and all you're getting, or what information has been incoming request and all, what information is it carrying. So there are several policies basically if you'll deep dive, and all of them are very easy to implement. Not just this, suppose if you're coming from some maybe a background where is like a financial organization or something which actually demands a large amount of security, and if the ready-to-made available policies, I mean the automated policies, are not working out in your favor, in that case you can also design your own custom policy. So even that's a very easy way to like maybe design. It could be as per your customized tailored policy as per the requirements you want. So even that policy, I mean the custom made policy which you, your developers have actually created, you can apply this custom made policy on the API gateway level as well.
Okay. Awesome. So thank you. Yeah. Thank you very much, Akshada. So first of all, I want to say thank you. First of all, in the beginning of your presentation, your headlines from the news on API breaches, one of those headlines was actually my vulnerability research into hacking mobile health apps and APIs. So thank you for drawing attention to that. That one was sponsored by Approve. This was a great presentation. I love how you went into so much depth in the different attacks that can be levied against APIs. One of the things that I wanted to ask you, so there's several questions that came in. Can you explain whether tokenization is enough, or should people also be using scopes? And are there ways around is there ways for hackers to get around scopes?
Okay, so definitely it depends on the use case, right? But tokenization is one of the ways. I mean, if you're dealing with the critical information, so tokenization is definitely the one which could be like very helpful, or it could actually provide you great insights. I mean, it's actually encrypting your information, right? The PII information. I'm not actually sure about the scopes which we are saying about. It could be like something like SLA or SLA Tarbay, something like that.
Yeah, I think what they're asking is, if you've ever seen tokens implemented, you can actually tie scopes to them and say, okay, Akshata can request this data, but she can't request that data because it's out of scope.
So tokenization will, in that case, it's like the authorization and the authentication which comes into picture. Like I'm authenticated to apply, like send an API request, but I'm not authorized to use a particular resources. So if, like you can take an example of maybe a banking system, like I am a user, I'm allowed to like make some pay accounts and detail information. I'm allowed to get those information, but I'm not allowed to like do some changes or get some information which is not in my scope. So in that case, I guess you can actually combine tokenization with your authentication authorization. So that will be giving you a maximum security.
Yeah, and this is why I love API days. And I know that the previous speakers have their positions on, you know, the best approach to API security. And what I love about API days is you have a voice from everyone. You have all these different perspectives. There's some who believe that WAFs aren't an effective approach, that API gateways aren't an effective approach. You know, so you, our audience is getting all these different perspectives from different luminaries in the industry like yourself, who have a different position on how API security should be implemented. In the case that you're presenting here through policies, we had previous presentations doing it through machine learning. I love this different approach. And one thing that I can tell all of you who may be confused is, I think the API security market is very much still in its infancy. It's going through this identity crisis and it's trying to figure itself out. There's all these different approaches to API security, through SDKs, passive monitoring, inline monitoring, shift left where, you're doing it while the code is being written, all the way to shift right to when it's in production, or shield right when it's in production. And then we had a presenter present on, the importance of shifting everywhere. So, I first of all, I want to applaud you because I want to definitely see more women in APIs. So thank you very much for presenting and being here today. I think this was all very important content. And I love that you presented a different approach to securing APIs through policies.
Thank you. It was a pleasure talking today and nice meeting you as well. Thanks, everyone. Thanks for joining.
Thank you, Akshata. And-